My name is Greg Fonzo. We are in Stanford, California, and my position is a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Psychiatry. So I was born in New York. Floral Park is where I grew up in Queens. I used to love to read. I've always been kind of a book worm, I guess you could say. You know, comic books as well when I was younger, collecting different kinds of, you know, trading cards and that kind of thing. I loved different kinds of sports. It's mostly baseball when I was younger, but then went into wrestling as I got a little bit older in high school. I was always interested in nature and sort of, you know, why things occur the way they do. What is it that makes certain birds make this sound? I'm trained as a clinical psychologist, so I do a lot of work with different patient populations. I specialize in post-traumatic stress disorder and other sorts of anxiety disorders. We look at both the structure of the brain and as well as how it functions in the context of a particular paradigm. We also just look at behavior. So for instance, people's self-report of how they've been doing lately. We look at measures of cognitive function using certain tasks or batteries. We might look at how they process emotional facial expressions or how they learn to regulate their emotional state. We use a lot of brain imaging technology here in the lab to look at the sorts of things that go awry in the brain that might give rise to a person, you know, expressing certain symptoms or having a likelihood to develop a disorder, not having to cut open anybody's head or anything to actually see what their brain is doing. Being able to design new treatments and have that design be based on information that we've collected from already existing treatments. Being able to direct people to the right treatments so that they can get the best possible medical care is really important. And the hope is with that, that will help to improve certain aspects of a person's functioning and their quality of life. There's a curiosity, I think, that really drives the people in the lab to understand, why do these things work? What's going on? It's a really lively and a vibrant kind of place to work. A lot of sharing of information and sharing of skills.
Because I started touching on that, okay, so I did all this sociology thing, and then I worked with two clinical psychologists after, and I started talking about the couple study, and then I'm like, well, should I mention Hector's too?
Veterans are generally a pretty highly motivated group of individuals. They like to work hard, they like to have a goal that they want to achieve, they like to work towards that goal, and they're generally very respectful and, I'd say, strong individuals in terms of their character. I think I've always been kind of modest and feeling like that, well, you know, can I really contribute to science? Can I really make a difference? Can I really do anything that, you know, is something special that maybe other people can't do? Don't base your decision on whether or not you think you can do something, but on whether or not you really want to do something. If you really want to go into science, to do medical research, if you're passionate about that, that will carry you a long way. The skills will come later. You know, you may not have all the skills right now, but if you have the passion, that will really help you and drive you along to acquire those skills. So I'd say don't underestimate your abilities. If you're passionate about something and if you really want to do it, you should give yourself the chance. And you will encounter rejection along the way. It's, you know, as much as we would like to not have to do that, it does happen, but it does not mean that you cannot eventually succeed. Rejection will be a part of that process, but if you can deal with that rejection and continue to believe and to move in the direction that you want to move in, success is practically inevitable.